Flashback.
Don't you die on me, damn it!
Heep is robbing!
Intubate, now! Cardiac arrest, he's in VFib!
Clear!
Hit him again.
Not your kind of people.
Clear!
You seem kind of phony. Everything's a lie.
How's he doing?
Well, he's stabilized. But it took too long. He's in a coma.
Something in your makeup.
What about him?
Some time. Yes, yes, I know. You would like to know how long. I'm afraid it's been 9 years.
You see this? Diamond Docks. Our new home.
V has come too.
Welcome back. Ragazzi. Welcome back. Questo è il progetto che continua. Questo trailer è tecnicamente dedicato a chi sta seguendo la Metal Gear Saga con me. Da sempre. Perché lo ha già visto. Lo ha già visto. E ora lo stiamo rivedendo. Il motivo per il quale vi ho rimostrato questo trailer fa parte della nostra discesa verso il finale. Una sorta di effetto pala di neve, in cui rotoleremo giù fino alla fine. In caduta libera. C'era una scena nuova, in effetti, o comunque non ancora vista, in questo trailer rispetto a quello che abbiamo giocato fino ad ora. Ma il motivo per il quale vi sto facendo vedere questi trailer è perché non voglio risparmiarvi nulla. Nulla. Niente. Abbiamo iniziato il capitolo 2. Skullface è morto. C'è tanto da ascoltare, tanto da vedere, tanto da fare. Come ha detto Miller. In qualche modo, la situazione sembra ben distante dall'essersi conclusa. Bentornati a The Phantom Pain. Penserete, in futuro, penserete moltissimo a questo mio rimostrarvi trailer. Ve lo garantisco. Ve lo garantisco. Eccoci qua. Ready. Steady. Go. Yann, grazie milady, mi hai fatto un dono enorme in una serata importante, grazie veramente di cuore. Stupende parole e che cercherò di eguagliare nell'importanza per questo inizio. Insomma, Diamond Dogs prosegue Big Boss ti osserva. Big Boss è cambiato. dalla scorsa live ho portato al limite quelli che abbiamo spiegato essere i punti demone. Avrei potuto e avrei voluto far avere questo cambiamento a Big Boss. Non oggi, non qui, non in questo momento. Ma vedete, il motivo per il quale non ho potuto esimermi dall'avere Big Boss trasformarsi in demone quando avrei voluto, piuttosto che appunto decidere di farlo adesso, è perché... Li abbiamo interrotti. Insomma, è che purtroppo il punto in cui avrei voluto trasformarlo non lascerebbe spazio a vedere nient'altro, in quanto non potremmo vederlo in azione. Perché non c'è niente dopo. Tuttavia, come avete capito ormai in questa serie, è mia prerogativa, passione, cuore, darvi un percorso. Un percorso del quale io ho controllo. E quindi, utilizzando strumenti a mia disposizione e la mia volontà di farlo, da questo momento in poi, John è un demone. Dopo aver sconfitto e ucciso Skullface con quella vendetta sanguinolenta, spietata e terribile. Questo è quanto. Dentro di lui si sta sviluppando un seme. E non è niente di positivo. Il Battle Gear è praticamente pronto. Non potremo mai usarlo in gameplay, per quanto fosse in pre-produzione pensato per essere potuto, appunto, essere coinvolto, essere usato, insomma, durante le missioni. Diventerà uno strumento per quelle esterne, scusate la confusione nella frase, ma è frustrante. Questo cut content ce lo porteremo dietro. È uno dei più visibili, proprio perché non fa nulla. È molto, molto più interattivo il Zeke in Peace Walker. Molto, molto, molto di più. Ma durante la pausa tra questa live e la precedente, ho recuperato un altro soldato da Mother Base, o meglio, di Mother Base. Sconvolto, fuori di testa, disperato. Ma è stato felice di rivederci. Quindi andiamo a trovare Paz. Aveva una foto con sé.
Stay back. It's too dangerous. Hey. Back up, kid. I said no. You have to stay back.
Some things can't be helped.
Back to your quarters.
What's going on?
Shabani. Mayaka 9 Kingoya. Shabani.
It's down there.
Hey, the tank at the bottom is filled with chlorine disinfectant. One whiff and you'll suffocate. Don't even.
How could you let it fall down there anyway?
Down there, and it is over.
Boss!
Hey, listen to me! There is no way to recover the body.
Diciamo che fondamentalmente ci sono un paio di cose da dire. Sappiamo che la relazione Venom, no? Big Boss e Quiet è assolutamente priva di fondamenta. Lei si innamora, lui si lega, a livello psicofilosofico ha un senso perché loro sono entrambi rogue, entrambe persone fuori da ciò che è fondamentalmente la società e ciò che rappresenta l'essere sociale, no? Classico. Ciò non di meno, nulla di questo viene approfondito, né ha una base logica, né una sorta di struttura narrativa che conduce al renderlo realistico o anche soltanto legato da un filone di sceneggiatura solido. Nulla, 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 nulla di questo ha realmente senso se non si dà già per scontato che ci sia questo rapporto assolutamente insensato e privo di costruzione, visto che lei cerca di ucciderlo, poi muore, rinasce e si innamora perché viene gonfiata. È una sorta di stranissimo rapporto il quale sarebbe potuto essere molto più interessante, ma che purtroppo per una serie di ragioni che abbiamo già in parte discusso, abbiamo visto purtroppo appiattirsi, no? Tuttavia, andiamo da Paz.
Boss?
What is it, Snake? Who took this? Strangelove? Maybe when she rubbed that sunscreen on me. Oh, I'm trying not to remember it. But you know, despite her quirks, Dr. Strangelove is a good person. I wish you'd come and say hello. I am so tired. I will just lie here a while.
E se avete seguito le live insieme a me, tutti insieme, sapete benissimo di cosa parlava, no? E questa è una cosa molto importante, ragazzi. Molto importante. Nelle precedenti serate abbiamo parlato di Paz, abbiamo parlato di tutto. Quindi per ora continua, e anzi inizia, il capitolo 2. Torniamo all'elicottero. E proseguiamo dopo la morte di Skullface in questa storia.
Please select a landing zone.
Roger. This is Pequot. Arriving shortly at LZ.
Comunque non credo sia assolutamente vero quello che ha detto prima Don Cape. Cioè, tu puoi tranquillamente uccidere Quiet e proseguire nella storia. Quiet è assolutamente secondaria nella trama. Non ha un ruolo. Cioè, Quiet è un companion che ha una side story, tra l'altro, terribile. Quindi no, non l'ho mai uccisa in una run, ma tu puoi ucciderla assolutamente. Non ci metterei la mano sul fuoco perché non l'ho fatto, ma è assolutamente è come non prendere DD. Cioè, non, certo che sono sicuro. Cioè, sono sicuro a livello di logica, non l'ho fatto, quindi non posso dire ci scommetto, ma si uccide. Non è assolutamente importante. Anzi, ho dovuto craccare la sua affezione nei miei confronti per essere sicuro di sbloccare Quiet Exit. Quindi cioè non. Ma chi se ne frega che non puoi fare una certa missione? È la sua missione. Ma chi se ne frega che ti sblocca le missioni? Le sue missioni non sono importanti. Oh, raga. È un personaggio secondario? Cioè. Non, Quiet è secondario. Tutto, è quasi tutto secondario in The Phantom Pain. Quindi no. Esattamente come era sbagliato per correggere chi ha seguito la live senza il montaggio, eccetera. Don, che non potessi raccogliere gli Skull perché non li avevo storditi, eccetera. Se basta ottenere la tuta e quindi sviluppare il wormhole. Cioè, certo, guarda che ucciderla non significa stordirla, significa ucciderla. Certo che ti sblocca le missioni secondarie, cioè le missioni avanzate. Però non è qualcosa che ho fatto, quindi non posso dirvi. Mano sul fuoco, il ragazzo ha torto, però. Insomma. Ecco, parlo per logica e conoscenza del gioco senza però aver fatto questa cosa io. Quindi occhio. Cioè non è da prendere, però secondo me si fa con Cheat Engine si fa una prova un secondo, un attimo. Poi la patch di Konami ha aggiunto il fatto di poterla riottenere. Ma quella è proprio una patch paraculo della software house. Le cutscene con Quiet poi non ci sono, ovviamente. Comunque. andiamo avanti. C'è molto da fare. Queste sono le ultime live di The Phantom Pain ed è molto importante farle bene. Ecco qua. Skullface è morto. Dovremmo annoiarci un po', ma è molto, molto importante ascoltare un po' di cose.
Skullface has finally burned out. The world is rid of his existence at last. Was he still alive? You could say that. But you could also say he'd been dead for decades.
What's that supposed to mean?
Biologically speaking, it's hard to say how much was his life.
Side effects from the treatment?
No. The primary effect. Keeping a dying host alive as long as possible. That is the whole point. But in the end, he grew too dependent on his children.
The Phantom Pain è ben localizzato e ben tradotto, ma alcune cose sono terribilmente rischiose da dire. È dying host, non dead host, ok? Morente, non morto. Perché chi ha seguito il mio giocare a The Phantom Pain in blind sa che io ho fatto notare due errori di traduzione gravissimi. Uno semplicemente di narrativa ambientale, quando hanno tradotto The Joy con gioia, come se fosse un'emozione, mentre sta parlando ovviamente di Boss, Lady Mercury, e poi un non rimosso, che cambia completamente tutta la trama del gioco. E quella cosa è grave. È come se in Guns of the Patriots ti avessero detto: ma senza mettere in mezzo il grande John, cosa potremmo dire? Cioè, ma il tuo Fox Die non è letale. Una cosa del genere, ecco. Qui è ancora più grave.
Skullface has finally poisoned. You could say that. But you could also say he'd be.
What's that supposed to mean?
Biologically speaking, it's hard to say how much was his
side effects from.
No.
Caution.
The primary effect. Keeping a dying host alive as long as possible. That is the whole point. But in the end, he grew too dependent on his children. As if he had any other way to keep on living. He first underwent parasite therapy before the Soviet Union became his home. His body was horribly burned. Fire washed across his thin young frame and stole his skin and his throat, even his lungs. Only through repeated therapies could the parasites keep him alive. Most of his life became something the parasites gave to him.
And then he lost the ability to die.
That is correct. The parasites live on past the host's death, still aiding cell composition. At that stage, there is no way to extract them from the host cells. There is no way of knowing when the last cell of Skullface's body would die. The only choice was to burn the whole thing. And his children, along with it. And I am one to talk. When my life is snuffed out, I expect you to treat my body the same way. And when I burn, I will truly be one with my children for the first time.
Quindi i parassiti non possono inabitare un corpo morto. Cioè, infettano qualcosa di vivo, morente, e poi, esattamente come capita a tutti noi, che ogni 7 anni praticamente, mi pare di ricordare la cifra sia questa, abbiamo fatto un cambio completo delle nostre cellule, o comunque delle nostre componenti biologiche in movimento, ormai il parassita è diventato completamente il corpo della nostra cara vittima. Però lo mantiene in vita. Quindi lui non avrebbe potuto sopravvivere con i polmoni bruciati, eccetera, ma i parassiti hanno fatto il lavoro. È praticamente un non è un foreshadowing, è praticamente una giustificazione di Quiet, senza che però vada a spiegare il perché invece lei si trasformi in un personaggio così. Oh beh.
And you tell me, Skull, you say there were three English vocal parasites.
According to Skullface, yeah.
Skullface had two of the English strain with him. You burned both of them.
There was an oil fire. I tossed him in.
So that just leaves one. And you tell me Skullface said he used it.
He said it was very close to me.
Very close. One of your comrades, or someone ordered to kill you, or he could have been speaking metaphorically.
Metaphorically?
Close to your spirit, close to your heart. Someone who either loves you or despises you.
The second one makes a long list.
Whichever it is, act with caution. Skullface implanted someone with the English language strain. Who it is irrelevant.
Why?
I tell you what Skullface really meant. Very close to you means you will be exposed. All the infected here have been given the Wolbachia. Even if the vocal cord parasites infect them now, they cannot reproduce. But if there's a different host among us, host to the English strain,
if that were the case, we'd see the symptoms.
What about the non-English speakers?
We have plenty of those, but the staff use English as a common language.
But if that someone has not spoken English yet, and begins to speak it now,
there'd be another outbreak.
The final mating pair of the English strain must be found immediately. Skullface is gone, but his threat still remains on this base. Do you see what the final mating pair is? With him dead, those parasites are the stain he wished to leave upon the world. His thirst for vengeance in the flesh. Think. Does anyone here bear a grudge against you? Who would target you specifically?
The ethnic cleansers that Code Talker mentioned, they weren't Skullface's true goal. All we have is circumstantial evidence, but here's my theory. It was Cypher who started developing the vocal cord parasites as bioweapons, parasitic weapons, and Africa was the testing ground for them. As Code Talker said, their purpose is the ethnic cleansing of only those who speak a particular language. So they could do a weapon of mass destruction to eradicate specific groups, races, ethnicities, or colonies by the language they speak. Or a kind of absolute language control. Or maybe a tool for those arrogant fools to build some misguided utopia. I can see plenty of uses for them. However, in practical terms, they wouldn't be as dangerous as you'd think. Counteracting the parasites is easy, after all. Cut them out of your throat to save your life, or just don't talk. That also prevents the infection from spreading. So if the international community were to find out about them, they'd no longer be the threat they were conceived to be. In which case, their targets would be limited to minority groups as a deterrent or a terrorist tool. It's hard to imagine Cypher developing something like that as a main weapon for their arsenal. That leads me to think we've only tugged on one little thread in Cypher's grand tapestry. An obscure corner of their work, possibly forgotten altogether. In any case, things changed. When Skullface was forced to relocate to Africa and he saw that thread dangling. All the time he continued that research, he was secretly following his own agenda. The ethnic liberator parasites, his English language strain. Skullface said there were only 3 samples of the English language strain parasite. I think we can believe him. Bringing his ethnic liberator's plan to fruition depended on creating an English version of the vocal cord parasites at all costs. But an English strain would have been useless to Cypher. Worse, it could have destroyed everything they'd built. It was the one type they couldn't allow. That means Skullface was forced to develop his English strain out of sight of Cypher's network. Naturally, he couldn't use the greenhouse facility Cypher had set up and filled with guinea pigs. Skullface must have found some secret place to create his precious few English parasites, hiding all evidence like a man cheating on his wife. Somewhere, an entirely standalone environment. And when his plan entered its final phase, he must have made the place disappear. Some little room, could be anywhere, but now nowhere at all. We'll never know where he did it, but to elude Cypher's surveillance, it couldn't have been big. I believe Skullface was telling the truth. There were only ever 3 samples of the English language strain. Why activate Sahelanthropus in Afghanistan? This is how Skullface wanted things to play out. The Soviet Union secretly develops a new type of nuclear weapon and successfully deploys it in Afghanistan. Revealing the existence of Sahelanthropus results in a return to the glory days of the Cold War. The threat it poses reignites the nuclear arms race between the world's major powers. The demand for nuclear weapons increases around the globe. What if you then introduced a nuclear weapon anyone could get their hands on? Non-nuclear nations, militant groups of all shapes and sizes, they'd all jump at the chance. Sahelanthropus was a marketing tool to sell nukes all around the world. But I think it's safe to say that plan was stamped out before it got up and running. The world's intelligence agencies never did turn up anything conclusive on it. After all, Sahelanthropus vanished before word could spread. Everything that's happened is already a fading memory, never to join the pages of history. Except for Cypher. Cypher won't forget. They'll already be working on something quietly beneath the surface. They'll use the pieces of data scraped together from this incident to build their own bipedal weapon. It'll take them a long time to complete it, but for now, the Greed Sector have found their new life's work. We'll have to be ready too.
Le piccole prime basi del progetto di Zero. Ma ne riparleremo. Ci sono, come vedete, audiocassette che si possono sbirciare, che potrebbero essere interessanti da ascoltare. Ma tempo al tempo. Ora, missioni. Lista missioni. 3 con un bel giallo. Questo significa che abbiamo una missione di trama da poter affrontare. Sapere troppo. Un soldato sovietico che collaborava con la CIA è scomparso. Recupera la talpa. Tuttavia, comincia ad esserci qualcosa di strano, ragazzi, ed è inutile fare i finti tonti. C2W rinforzi il supporto. Livello di difficoltà elevato. Sono le stesse missioni. Che abbiamo già fatto. Questo, per qualunque giocatore in blind, non suona bene. Perché la difficoltà elevata non è un'opzione? E nel capitolo 2, invece sono qui, come missioni numerate consecutive. Missioni numerate, consecutive, con modalità di gioco più complesse e avanzate, che potevano essere un'opzione per tutte? Quindi io non posso giocare alla difficoltà sopravvivenza? Tutte le armi e gli oggetti sono reperibili in loco, nulla che ti porti dietro con il tuo setup. E non posso giocarmi le altre così? No, no, solo queste. Ah... Ma scusa, come fa a procedere la trama ripetendo gli eventi? Non lo fa.
Mission accepted, heading to Afghanistan.
Allora, Quiet non la porteremo a essere completamente coperta di sangue. Tuttavia, ha equipaggiato il Brennan, un fucile di grosso calibro. E Boss non ha più armi per stordire. Siamo vicini all'obiettivo dove dobbiamo trovare questa talpa. Questa è, a conti fatti, una missione di trama che va avanti con la storia, perché ha un nome unico e non è ripetuta. Tuttavia, cominciano ad apparire, no? Queste cose molto strane. E Quiet non verrà fermata neanche dai caschi più solidi. Non si gioca più, ragazzi. Il sole del deserto e l'odore del sangue, nel mentre Quiet continua a sparare. Un colpo, un morto. Ha completamente annichilito tutta la base, ragazzi, da sola. Ok, avete visto? Avete visto? Cosa abbiamo fatto? Bene. E sì, si può ottenere S anche uccidendo. E perché? Beh. Beh. Andiamo avanti.
He betrayed the Soviets, passing information to Langley, but got scared after learning XOF used the vocal cord parasites. Then came feelings of guilt that his leak sent comrades to their deaths, and fear that America might deploy such a weapon itself. But in reality, XOF and Langley don't have a collaborative relationship, and Skullface was not working for America. Still, I can't blame the man for being afraid. After laying low with the Mujahideen, He tried to cut his ties with the U.S. and return to the Soviet military. But along the way, someone came after him, and he was forced back into hiding. Could have been remnants of XOF looking to silence him. And you know the rest. He doesn't seem to know much about the parasites, but nevertheless, it'd be too dangerous to hand him over to Langley or the Soviets. We'll keep him here as originally planned.
Stiamo ottenendo ciò di cui abbiamo bisogno per quanto concerne la trama e il Battle Gear è stato completato. Ora può essere inviato come unità rara. Come unità rara. Lo è, però vabbè. Come unità nelle missioni esterne.
Emmerich's finished development on that Battle Gear of his. Get back to Mother Base.
Vedete che ho pianificato un po' di cose? Quanto è complicato e noioso farlo su The Phantom Pain, ragazzi, non ci avete idea. Bello, eh? Bello, bello deve essere giocarci con l'over. Così poi potremo pilotarlo anche no. Ah, tutto questo progetto hovercraft, no? Che appunto lo fa fluttuare così di non avere problemi con le open map. Ah, già, andiamo avanti. Miller già non accetta Quiet ed è rimasto un po' titubante quando l'ha vista sacrificarsi per un bambino, giusto per non far sentire Boss in una posizione sgradevole. Adesso, ovviamente, Yui ha fatto questo nostro favore. Ah, ci ha fatto questo favore, ma...
Unit dispatched.
Allora, ora abbiamo missioni secondarie da fare, no? Dobbiamo recuperare l'IA Pod. Il nostro... sopravvissuto la Peace Walker. Tuttavia, prima di farlo, stiamo recuperando le fotografie, i ricordi di Paz, i nostri ex fratelli. E lo faremo ascoltando audiocassette durante il percorso notturno. Ciò che ricopre i teschi, ragazzi.
That covers the parasite that lives on the surface of the skull's bodies is what gives them their power, similar to my children who live in my skin. I modified the parasites I isolated from the body of that old man, differentiating them with various abilities. One that can blend perfectly into its surroundings by exposing the pigments in its cells at will. Another that, by harboring multiple species of metallic archaea, can oxidize and reduce metal. Isolating the one that covers and transplanting it into an artificial medium should provide the same abilities as the skulls, but they can only subsist within a human body. Once transplanted into the medium, they will eventually die. Another thing, the weakness of the one that covers is desiccation. Their surface moisture loss is greater than ours. The reason they give off mist is to alleviate this by releasing the salts inside them as microparticles. Water vapor condenses around them, appearing as mist. But this dries out the atmosphere until they cannot even produce mist. And once their supply of water from the host runs out, the parasites are in danger. They, along with their host, enter a form of suspended animation. However, a similar effect occurs if they come into contact with a large amount of water. Rain, for instance. The one that covers will temporarily abandon other processes in his eagerness to absorb the water. Pitiholone, make the weather your ally.
Ragazzi, non per essere un po' pungente, ma se l'obiettivo è utilizzare questa missione secondaria per farvi ascoltare delle audiocassette, e ho persino camminato per non correre, cacchio la prendo a fare la Jeep. Sarebbe un errore prenderla giù.
This is Yellow Cape that Cypher was having the PF's transport. Before we met you, the boss recovered it from a truck crossing the savannah. Are there metallic archaea inside it?
Yes, the archaea metabolize uranium-235 to subsist. They must be stored inside Yellow Cake, or they cannot survive.
So those biological traces we took for impurities were actually the real cargo?
Of course they are deactivated, so they do not trigger a sudden enrichment. They are like baker's yeast. Yet, they do gradually enrich the uranium as they feed. I imagine you detected weapons-grade traces.
Yeah, we did. And the malachite that was loaded on the truck had traces of uranium in it, too. So that's the flower, huh? Skullface was gonna sell do-it-yourself new kits. The uranium-enriching archaea complete with the user's manual. And the ores with the uranium could be sourced by the client or provided by Cypher.
Even the trace amounts buried in common ores can be enriched to weapons-grade uranium by the metallic archaea. Proving that must have been the most important factor of the trials. That, and the ability to successfully prevent detonation.
So if the amounts of uranium in the ores are low enough, they can get past any inspection. And you only need a tiny amount of the archaea to act as the yeast. No great challenge to smuggle that either. The first step towards saturating the world with nukes.
His plan. That was not my intention. My only goal in developing the metallic archaea was to save the Diné.
What made you think a tool for creating undetectable nuclear weapons would save your people?
After 70 years, the Diné reclaimed the Navajo Nation from which we were banished. We bore all the hardships of poverty, but we were proud to live off the land we called our own. But in the moment the atomic bomb was dropped on Hiroshima, everything changed.
I don't get it.
The nuclear arms race between the US and the Soviet Union began with the end of the Second World War.
Lane approaching.
Suddenly, there was a massive demand for uranium. And it was our ill fortune that the ground beneath the Navajo Nation was rich with uranium ore. The Blakana government set up mine after mine, and many of the Diné worked them. Never informed of any danger. Every day, they went to work with no protection. The slag was simply piled out in the open. When rain fell, uranium traces left behind would seep out, and when the ground dried, it was blown about as dust. Land and water were contaminated, irradiated. Many of us became sick and died. That pain lives on to this day.
I have no idea.
Wanting more than anything to revive the land my forebears left to me, I was delighted upon discovering microbes that eat uranium. If they could be domesticated, I believed we could rid our land of uranium.
Were you successful?
No. The research called for funding on a colossal scale. But nobody was willing to invest with no prospect of a return.
And that's when Skullface showed up.
Correct. I can save you and your people. We share the same will. That is what he said to me. And I believed him. Blakana forced me to abandon my uranium cleanup work and focus on nuclear weapons. And he held all the Diné hostage. Today, the uranium mines within the reservation are finally closing down. It is simply less expensive now to source uranium overseas.
New victims, different places.
But uranium is a tactical resource. To rely on a foreign country for it is a difficult decision to make. And he was in the perfect place to influence that decision.
He could have condemned your people to the mines forever.
The contamination comes not only from uranium. The fallout from the Nevada nuclear tests also settled on our lands. As if our fortune were not already bad enough, we are also downwinders. To save the Diné.
That's the target.
I must complete my
order. I remember him. He was off base during the attack 9 years ago. Bring him home, boss.
Questa sarà l'unica audiocassetta che vi costringerò ad ascoltare, che non sia importante. Però dovevamo chiudere il personaggio di Cot Walker. Quindi è tutto secondo i piani, ragazzi. Però era troppo importante. Per quanto concerne la nostra missione opzionale, non è qui. Quindi... vi ricordate questa base, sì? La nostra missione era non farsi vedere, nascondersi e rapire o salvare Huey Hemerich. Stavolta gli obiettivi sono molto... No, diversi. Vero? Una terribile tortura. Beh. Coprimi, Quiet.
Sure.
sembra che ci sia.
I may no longer be able to bear children, but I still have a family. Jack, is it you? I've been waiting, Snake, for a long time.
Abbiamo visto tempo addietro le foto, già fatto. Quanto volevo questa scena col corno al massimo.
AI pod launch confirmed. We'll pick it up. I wonder what kind of secrets are buried in it. I'll let you know if we learn something. Got a report from the intel team.
Già.
Remember how the man on fire was crushed by Sahelanthropus? Well, the Soviets recovered his body. Could he really be dead? Boss, head for Yaha Ohu's supply outpost and secure the man on fire's body. If Skullface was right, and a thirst for revenge can turn a man into a demon and keep the dead alive, and this man on fire who's been coming after us ever since you woke up, the left of our old friend Volgan.
Finalmente qualche spiegazione. Eh?
Marker placed.
Andiamo.
That the man on fire was crushed under Sahelanthropus in its hangar.
Yeah. He was caught under the wheels of its transport platform.
Yeah. But his body wasn't found.
What?
We searched the area the moment we arrived, but there was no trace of him.
I wasn't hallucinating.
I know. I trust you on that. That means someone must have taken the body. But when I got there, everything was still as it was. Even Skullface hadn't been touched. I can't see a reason to sneak into a place like that and drag out the biggest, heaviest guy there.
What are you getting at?
Only option left is... He got up and walked away.
That platform ran him over.
Just ran him over.
You're saying that's not enough?
I don't want to believe it, but... Maybe not. He shrugs off bullets, even rocket strikes. There's no reason to think that would finish him. It seems ridiculous, but... I'll start gathering eyewitness accounts just in case.
If you dig up anything concrete, I want to know.
You'll be the first, if I dig anything up. But I hope to hell I don't.
No kidding.
È abbastanza evidente il fatto che comunque le audiocassette danno una certa dignità a quello che succede anche quando apparentemente è privo di un senso logico, l'enorme potere di questa entità infiammabile, cioè, infiammabile, di questa entità in fiamme, è riconosciuto dalle parole di Ocelot. Allora, possiamo ancora ascoltare qualcosa, ossia, delle parole sul Sahelanthropus.
About this OKB-0 Emmerich was talking about. Its location and features match the citadel in the mountains northeast of the Soviet base camp. Built during the time of Alexander the Great, it was left in ruins following one of Genghis Khan's campaigns. Its occupants changed time and again due to war, and it was expanded on more than one occasion. Ultimately, it fell into the hands of the Soviet philosophers. The Soviet army was using it as the headquarters of its Afghan invasion force. But it would seem that Skullface's connection with the philosophers gave him license to develop Sahelanthropus there. And that's what Emmerich was doing at the place. before he got the axe. But OKB is a designation the Soviets use for weapon design bureaus. There's no way they'd have one of those in Afghanistan. And in principle, the numbers that follow OKB are always integers above one. There is no zero. Perhaps this was a secret facility of the Soviet and Chinese philosophers dating back prior to World War II. Though it's more likely Skullface just picked a fake name that more or less fit the Soviets' pattern. He doesn't go there often, but he sure as hell won't miss this. They use the heliport on top of the tower for his visits. Start by heading for the heliport. Then wait for your chance to make contact with Skullface.
It seems Subtilanthropus' armor is made from depleted uranium. That offers some serious protection. The U.S. military is planning on using it for its main battle tanks, too. Maybe that's where Emmerich got the technology.
Uranium? They're using nuclear fuel for armor now?
No. What they use for nuclear fuel is uranium-235, which is extracted from natural uranium. Depleted uranium is a byproduct of that process. Sort of like the leftovers, I guess. The garbage. Uranium-235 makes up 0.72% of natural uranium, whereas depleted uranium contains only 0.2%.
What are the benefits of using it for armor?
It's a pretty short list. Uranium's a heavy metal, like lead, meaning it can hold a greater amount of kinetic energy. But it also boasts a hardness closer to tungsten. That makes it an ideal material to use for, say, armor-piercing ammunition penetrators. But it's not the best choice for armor. Its volume is less than that of ceramics, but for an equal weight, you could end up with less protection.
So why use it then?
According to Emmerich, it came down to him being unable to source ceramics technology from a manufacturer. Plus, given that it's an upright walking vehicle, he wanted to reduce the bulk of certain areas. Despite all that, depleted uranium still makes for some tough armor. And Emmerich says it's been proven in live fire tests. It stops most Soviet tank shells. Emmerich didn't go with depleted uranium for Sahelanthropus' armor because of its strength.
He had nukes in mind.
Exactly. It's meant to use its body as the fuel component for a nuclear weapon. Sahelanthropus uses built-in uranium enrichment archaea to melt its own body and extract uranium-235 from the depleted uranium in its armor. Those archaea perform the enrichment in an extremely short time. The concentration jumps by a factor of several hundred, from 0.2% to over 90%, the end result being highly enriched weapons-grade uranium. Sahelanthropus' body itself becomes a nuclear bomb. Emmerich says if it were to self-destruct, the nuclear yield would be somewhere in the region of 15 kilotons. Since you need about 50 kilograms of highly enriched uranium to trigger a nuclear reaction, that would mean Sahelanthropus contains something like 23 tons of depleted uranium.
That's not very much.
No, it isn't. That's about what you'd expect to find in a main battle tank's armor. The point is, it can be transported anywhere, even use its conventional weaponry on the battlefield. And the international community will never suspect a thing.
The map has been updated.
I just received word from the R&D team and the transport team out of Afghanistan. They finished installing Sahelanthropus on the base. It's ours now.
All right. Don't let any of the staff touch that thing. Especially Emmerich.
Of course. That guy's crush on Sahelanthropus is beyond a joke. Guess he really wants to see his tech stand on its own two legs this time.
That's not gonna happen.
I know it. So you've got no plans to make it operational again?
Damn right.
Boss, I want to hear it straight from you.
Hear what?
What the hell do you want with that thing? The drive is busted. It's not like it has a nuke on board. Even if the metallic archaea could turn it into a nuclear weapon, all it could do is self-destruct. Sahelanthropus just isn't a weapon anymore. It'll draw unwanted attention without even being a deterrent.
I know.
The weapons development strut sank 2 feet under that thing's wake. That's 1 year's drop in a single night. We've started on reinforcing the strut, but there's no guarantee it'll hold up if a storm hits.
I know that too.
Boss, why keep it?
It's a mark. Us Diamond Dogs, we don't have a country to call home. That means we have no past, nothing to prove that we lived.
Every one of us threw it all away when we came here. Sahelanthropus is a symbol to show that the likes of us brought at least one crisis to its end.
A mark in history. So we can't just fade away.
It's of no practical use to us. But we still need it.
A symbol of what we've done. I'm glad I sounded you out on this. Snake, on behalf of all of us, I want to thank you.
I don't need gratitude. I need security. Keep Emmerich away from that thing.
Roger that.
Post captured.
Allora, questa scena in cui l'uomo di fuoco, ovviamente senza il potere di Mantis, perde la sua efficacia in un ultimo burst di energia, ricordatevelo per sempre, fino alla fine della serie. È un po', ho detto un po' una cosa all'opposto dell'altra, ma questa scena sarà la chiave di una delle mie più feroci critiche e dispiaceri. Questa scena, il fatto che esista, è veramente importante per farvi capire un dispiacere non obiettivo. Sapete benissimo che è importante distinguere, ma dei non obiettivi, questo per me è uno dei top, ma a tempo debito.
I barely recognize you, Colonel. Skullface used your thirst for revenge against Big Boss, did he?
Questa parte della mappa della Mother Base sarebbe potuta essere una sorta di...
Boss, I've updated the mission list. We've received some new job offers. The details are on your iDroid.
Poteva essere una sorta di... stanza dei trofei alla Ivalis, alla Final Fantasy XII, e invece non ha alcun valore. Nessuno sviluppo, niente di niente. Ciò non di meno, la live non finirà qui. Andiamo a fare una prossima missione. Abbiamo bisogno di avanzamento. Abbiamo nuove chiamate? Sfruttiamole. Ora vi farò vedere una cosa interessante.
Mission list updated.
Mission list updated. Se si va sulla lista missione, abbiamo, dopo il sapere troppo, ancora altre missioni ripetute, ma un'altra con il nome unico. Si passa dalla 32 alla 35, quindi abbiamo di trama 32 e 35. Il resto è la comitiva dei traditori e impronte di fantasmi. In altre parole, quindi si richiede il massimo livello di furtività. Sono modalità extra che non sono selezionabili per ogni missione, ma vengono utilizzate come riempitivo di qualcosa che comincia a puzzare veramente di marcio. Qui in Blind è molto molto preoccupante, perché non si capisce il motivo per il quale prima abbiamo avuto tutte missioni diverse e narrative, e qui invece ripetizioni, e per ripetizioni si intende duplicati veri e propri. Duplicati veri e propri. Ai ai ai. Ciò non di meno, qui abbiamo da recuperare i due container carichi con materiali di ricerca di Code Talker. I container sono nascosti nella giungla e gli elicotteri della Xoth stanno per recuperarli. Di nuovo si torna a missioni di trama che non sembrano importanti, quelle veramente pregne di contenuto, di gameplay, anche interessanti e più originali di quelle che sono praticamente side ops con narrativa più centrale alla strada magna della storia, eccetera, però comunque perlomeno si va avanti. Eredità maledetta sarà il finale della nostra serata. Pronti ragazzi? Siamo dinanzi alla casa di Code Talker, e il discorso che ho fatto poco fa sulle missioni principali qui si va in qualche modo a evidenziare, perché la missione 35 è apparsa in maniera così consecutiva alle nostre scelte proprio grazie al fatto che abbiamo eseguito e completato determinate numero e missioni secondarie, altrimenti non sarebbe apparso, e devi cominciare a giocare cercando di capire come poter andare avanti senza essere costretto a magari pensare di fare quelle dannate missioni duplicate. Ora, qui, recupereremo i materiali di Code Talker. Brava Quiet. Stiamo giocando al gatto e al topo qui. Nessuna pietà. Ve l'ho detto che avremmo potuto cominciare a lanciare i missili su questa casa. Ci hai pensato tu? Ma che brava.
Radar still hasn't picked up the enemy choppers. But it's only a matter of time before they arrive. I've updated the info on your iDroid. Take a look.
Grazie.
The PF soldiers have no idea what's in those containers. Strictly a need-to-know basis.
Il mio ponte! C'è bisogno. Il bersaglio è nostro. Questo è un dettaglio molto bellino. Davvero? Non è rimasto nessuno? Molto bene. Oh, quiet. Sempre un passo avanti a me.
Boss, we got code talker Offer's research materials back in one piece. The medical team has them under lock and key in the quarantine facility. The materials should help their research into the vocal cord parasites. Cypher won't be getting their hands on them now.
State notando per caso molte audiocassette come premio? È quel che sembra, sì. Ora, per salutarci.
Boss, about that AI pod you retrieved from Emmerich's research facility. Guess what we found inside? A corpse. Human. The pod maintained a low internal temperature the whole time, and very little outside air got in. That would have slowed down decomposition. Still, the remains were mostly skeletal. Estimated time of death is between 6 months and a year ago. We put the screws to Huey about it. Listen to the tape. Turns out it was the body of someone we knew very well.
La prossima volta.
Volgan, the GRU colonel, was burned alive with the Shagohod during Operation Snake Eater 20 years ago. Despite suffering severe burns to his entire body, he still clung to life. After you left Seleniarsk, Volgan's body was taken to a research institute in the outskirts of Moscow. But modern medicine couldn't explain why he was still alive. Not that the colonel was any ordinary man to begin with. That constant electric current he had running through his body that he could unleash at will. To be honest, I was always uncomfortable around him. Thought I might get electrocuted just by standing nearby. The institute studying him was tasked with investigating and developing human paranormal abilities. The comatose Volgan was used to further the Soviet Union's research into such abilities. But not long ago, the facility burned to the ground. And Volgan's body was never found among the rubble, even though the fire started in the room where they were keeping him. This occurred at around the same time you woke up. If Skullface was right, and a thirst for revenge can turn a man into a demon and keep the dead alive, then this man on fire who's been coming after us ever since you woke up, well, that just might be what's left of our old friend Volgan. It's not over yet. Back in 64, in Seleniarsk, you brought his plans for a utopia down in flames. That grudge is what's keeping him alive. The day the research facility holding Volgan burned down, a Soviet jumbo passenger jet happened to crash nearby, far away to the north of that hospital in Cyprus. On board the plane was a young boy who was being studied at the same facility. The plane fell to Earth from over 8,000 feet, but the boy's body was the only one not recovered. At almost exactly the same time as the crash, Volgan awoke in that facility. According to the Research Institute's documents, the gifts this boy demonstrated included psychokinesis and telepathy. To protect his mind from being inundated with other people's thoughts, he always wore a kind of gas mask. A rudimentary form of psychic insulation, apparently. We don't know where this boy is, but if Skullface is connected to him, we may cross paths with him yet. This boy is part of a new age where nothing we understand about the world makes sense anymore. Don't let your guard down.
Ma perché invece i Wolbachia sono la cosa più comprensibile del mondo, vero, Damska? Allora, ragazzi, qui si conclude la live di The Phantom Pain. È stata, nonostante tutto, molto ben strutturata, secondo i miei piani. Le cose si muovono, la strada è questa. Come potete notare, c'è molto Death Stranding prima ancora che esca, no? Prima ancora che si sappia molto sul progetto, visto che è stupendamente tenuto in riservo, perché non sempre è importante sapere tutto durante il processo di sviluppo. Per quanto è arrivato il momento adesso, questo E3, spero di poter vedere più gameplay. Non troppo, perché se parte del gioco Beh, non bisogna per forza comprarlo se uno non vuole acquistarlo senza sapere, eh. Però insomma, la vena creativa si sfoga in The Phantom Pain. Però, ragazzi, alla prossima. C'è parecchio, parecchio ancora di cui parlare. Siamo al nucleo di tutto il lavoro. E... Semper Fi.